And thank you, everyone, for, and thank you for joining us today. So this is a listening session, so I don't want to talk too much, but I do want to provide a bit of a background before we get started. A link to a document has been put into the chat for your convenience. The document is the framework that outlines how the feasibility study is being conducted and provides additional information. First and foremost, I want to make sure everyone on the call and in this town hall understands that no decisions have been made. Right now, I am collecting data in order to make a recommendation to the Board of Health. I anticipate presenting this recommendation at the September Board of Health meeting. The decision the board will be making at that point is whether to have me move to step two. The purpose of the first step is to figure out if separating treatment services from SRHD is a good idea. And would it be in the best interest of the public to separate? And some of you might be thinking, why would we consider such a thing since the opioid crisis is so bad in Spokane County? Well, why are we conducting the feasibility study now? In part, it is because of the urgency of the situation. The treatment services program at SRHD is the singular largest opioid treatment program in Washington State. We serve approximately 1,000 clients who are actively enrolled in our program. But is that enough? Anecdotally, we know we are turning away at least 5 people a week who want to be assessed for admission into our program. If we separate from SRHD, would the new organization be able to move quickly and expand services to meet the increased need? As a governmental agency, we are bound by governmental processes and can't move quickly. Plus, our focus has to be on being wise stewards of taxpayer dollars. And last year, treatment services ended the year needing to be supplemented by the general fund, and that essentially is the taxpayer dollars. This hasn't happened very often, but it is a concern. Do the public health benefits of having treatment services under SRHD outweigh the cost to the taxpayer? There are some very public healthy things that we do at our treatment services program. Would an outside organization be able to continue these client-focused services? We don't know. These are just a few examples of the questions that are being grappled with in the first part of this study. I encourage you to read the framework for more information. And our hope for this afternoon is to hear from you about your thoughts on the possibility of treatment services separating. We have had 8 listening sessions with SRHD employees that were very informative and helpful. We've now held 2 previous town halls, and this is our 3rd. We want to hear from community members and hear from you, find out what do you want to know. And so we do have some questions to prompt your thinking of what we want to hear about. And again, please put your questions and comments in the chat, and we will respond to them in the order that we receive them. So with that, the questions that I've been pretty much asking everyone are, what concerns do you have about the potential of treatment services separating from SRHD? What do you want to make sure is addressed as the data is being collected? Are there potential benefits you can see of treatment services being run by a private business? Do you have thoughts on the potential impact of a private company running treatment services regarding access to care, treatment quality, and community needs? And is there anything else you want us to know as we move forward with this feasibility study? And so, with that, Kelly, do we have some questions or comments in the chat?
We do have some. So I think one of the first ones is just like, what concern? Oh, never mind. You added these. These are our questions for everybody else. So, no, we do not. So let's see. Wait, here we go. So one of our attendees is just curious if there are examples of private business coming in and doing this work and improving the outcomes.
That's a great question. And we, as I'm moving forward and beginning to have conversations with other opioid treatment programs, I am asking to look at their KPIs or key performance indicators and to see whether or not their outcomes are successful as far as client retention. One thing about that question, though, that I want to make sure is clear is that the definition of success of an opioid treatment program is really based on their treatment model. And so the treatment model at Spokane Regional Health District's treatment services is harm reduction. And so if, for example, addiction is a chronic disease. And so, as a chronic disease, we are trying to reduce the harm of addiction for our clients. That's what we're there for, to help them with. And there are some misunderstandings around addiction and that it is a chronic disease. And so, we at SRHD, we consider it a tremendous success when an individual is able to have a productive, contributing life, that they are meeting their goals, their objectives, their dreams, and still receiving medication-assisted treatment. And they could be on the program for 15 years, and that's considered success because they have a chronic disease and they're taking the medication that helps them to manage their chronic disease. That's a harm reduction approach. As I'm beginning to interview and talk to other opioid treatment programs, they might have differing views on what success looks like. And I hope that answered your question.
Yeah, another question is, there are other organizations providing treatment services in Spokane, and how would this proposed privatization be different than that?
Well, we do have two other organizations currently in the Spokane County area that provide opioid treatment programs. And they are both for-profit organizations. And basically, with this process, one of the considerations that the Board of Health will be taking into consideration is all of the public healthy things we do. And so as we move forward, again, this decision has to be in the best interest of the public. So, what I have heard from my listening sessions is that some for-profit organizations really focus on getting a lot of patients through. And so they have really high caseloads. And one client shared with me as I was interacting with clients that he's gone to other treatment programs and has just felt like he was being herded through the process, that he wasn't really being treated like a person. And from clients, from researchers, from employees, I'm hearing that the culture that we've developed at Treatment Services is really a culture of caring, one of respect and dignity, and honoring our clients as individuals, and being thankful that we're able to be a part of their recovery journey.
You.
Did I cover
yes,
that?
Yes, I think so.
Well, okay.
this next question, you had in previous conversations with employees and with the community talked about some of the challenges Treatment Services faces where we have to turn some clients away and the challenges we face in being able to staff
right.
and those levels. Can you please explain some of that with
sure.
this audience?
Sure. So what typically happens, or at least what has happened in my experience when I've been working in federally qualified health centers, is if we identify an expanded need, for example, among and we're not meeting that need in the community, we would work through a pro forma, which would say, okay, if we're going to meet this need, how many staff do we have to bring on? How many encounters would we have to generate in order to cover the costs? And through that process, that cost-benefit process, we would then, without having the funds up front, we would make a decision, okay, we know that eventually this is going to cover the cost of doing this additional service, and we would go ahead and move forward to hire employees. Within our structure as a governmental entity, we have to show that we have the funds available before we can bring on additional employees. And as I mentioned already, last year, the treatment services ended with a shortfall that had to be covered by the taxpayer dollars. And so expanding our the number of employees that we have won't be a consideration until we have the actual dollars to cover those expanded employee positions. And so right now, what's happening is we have intake for an individual at Treatment Services takes approximately 3 hours. They have to meet with a counselor, go through the process of seeing if they're eligible. We have to make sure that their addiction is an addiction that is covered in the treatment that we offer and many other things. But then they also have to have a clinical assessment and a workup. And so it's a detailed process that they have to go through. And we typically have 4 to 5 slots for assessments a day. And so there are days when there's all of the assessment slots are filled, someone walks in, wants to be assessed, and we're not able to assess them to get them enrolled into the program. And so it would require expanding our staffing and probably our hours as well.
Do you think that if we, that covering that expansion, that would be something, is that something that you're looking into with this feasibility study?
Absolutely. That is one of the critical components of why we're doing this, because under a private business structure, they don't have the same restraints that we do in government. They're actually able to be more nimble and responsive to the need within communities.
So hold on, I just lost my place. So So, if we were to privatize, or if they were to be privatized, would that enable the organization to have satellite clinics or be in other areas where the service is needed in Eastern Washington?
So actually, I'm just beginning to have interviews with other organizations that might be interested in taking on treatment services. And I did meet with an organization yesterday, had about a 3.5 hour conversation with them. And that actually is a model that they are actively working towards, is having satellite. This particular one was in Idaho. And so they've been actively working with the Federally Qualified Health Center in the panhandle of Idaho to work through having satellite locations at their clinics. So this particular company that I talked to yesterday, that is something that they are actively doing. And it's a very large organization. They have about 117 opioid treatment programs. And they're doing that wherever possible throughout the states that they're in.
You had mentioned in your opening remarks that there was a shortage, and how that, can you explain how what that was due to, and if moving to the new location played any part in that, and otherwise the financial health of treatment services, that it's normally fully self-sufficient.
So, Misty, do you feel up to responding to this question in regards to the reasons for the shortfall last year?
Sure. So some of the issues, and Alicia, I know that you've spoken on this previously, is that with Medicaid, there was some changes, and I'll let you're more eloquent on that topic. But I do want to address the fact that one of the main issues that has impacted all opioid treatment programs across the country was the fentanyl epidemic that has impacted all communities. And what we had in our community was we've had noticed that as fentanyl impacted our patient population, it resulted in a decrease in our census, largely due to the fact that we had a difficult time maintaining individuals and their stability. Our medical team worked diligently with our state and federal officials, trying to find the best ways to reach the patient population and to help stabilize them. But during that time, it was incredibly difficult to get our individuals engaged and to retain them because they were struggling so much. So the fentanyl crisis really had a significant impact on that, and which caused again a decrease in our patient census numbers. So that was where our numbers decreased from 22 through 20 throughout 2023.
And then, in regards to what Misty was referring to about Medicaid, when the pandemic was declared to be over, Medicaid changed their process. They had like put it on hold that people had to regularly reapply for their Medicaid benefits. They just kept getting them without having to reapply. And then when the pandemic was declared over, then a lot of individuals didn't, in a timely manner, submit eligibility criteria to Medicaid, and they were dropped off of Medicaid and no longer had insurance. And so that was another reason. And, we also talked about the fact that we do have two other providers in the community. And we do know that 53 individuals chose to leave our services and move to the services of one of those other private providers. And so it was kind of a mix of things that caused our census to drop, which in turn, it's a fee-based program. Our treatment services is expected to bring in enough money from the services provided to cover the costs of business. And that means that we need to maintain a certain level of client care to generate those fees.
Great. We actually have a couple people on that are concerned about the privatization of treatment services because they're concerned about the care for the clients and other entities taking advantage of the opioid crisis to make a profit. And so maybe you can share how we're considering that as we do the feasibility study.
Absolutely. So, with the help of everyone who has provided me with input, and every time we have something like this, I gain more knowledge. And so, I ha actually have a checklist of all the things that are really important about our program, the making sure that people have access to the services. And that means access physically with bus passes, and making sure they have a way to get to our services if they're not eligible for the Medicare or the Medicaid transport. To making sure that if they're having financial issues or don't have insurance, we have a sliding fee scale, we have a hardship payment program, and we really work diligently to help everyone to be able to stay on the program, who wants to stay on the program. And so I'm asking those hard questions about, do you have a sliding fee program? Do you have a hardship payment program? How do you ensure that access is open to anyone? And so I am asking those questions. I'm also asking questions about, because we heard a lot of employee concerns about benefits and that kind of thing. So I'm also asking questions about that.
So if someone was interested, an interested provider, for example, how do you set up that interview and have that discussion?
So far, what has happened is that they reach out to Misty. They say, "Hey, Misty, I heard about this. Can you get co me connected?" Because everybody knows Misty. She walks in that world, right? Has a lot of connections. She's on the board of ATOD and the ATOD. And so they send her an email. She forwards it to me. I reach out to them. We identify a date and time. And I was going to print this out because I have a fairly lengthy list of individuals that I'm already scheduled to meet with, who are expressing interest. So.
So I have someone that
You can also,
go
sorry,
ahead. No, go ahead.
if there is someone like that's on this town hall meeting who is interested, and they don't know Misty, they could always send an email to the email that was shared earlier. I think it's communications underscore web at srhd.org, and ask to be connected with me.
This question, I'm not completely sure what you're asking, so I'm sorry if I don't ask this right, but you were asking about the sliding scale. Does that help someone who's homeless without funds? Like, do we have
Oh,
clients?
absolutely. And see,
Yeah.
that's exactly what we're talking about. When we talk about access to care, we want to make sure that anyone who is suffering with an opioid addiction, who wants to address their chronic condition, we want to make sure that they have access. And so we do have a sliding fee scale. We have a contract with Spokane County, SBDG funding that allows us to offer a sliding fee scale. And so, based on that sliding fee scale, if anyone comes to us and they're under 100% federal poverty level, all of the costs of the services are covered. They're not expected to contribute anything other than their willingness to participate and do the work required to address their addiction. So, I want to add one more thing about that. Sorry.
No, it's okay.
Is that now there's with the opioid settlement dollars, the states that are involved in that litigation process and are receiving those dollars, many of them are using some of those dollars to actually fund that type of access so that opioid treatment programs can provide sliding fee scales with those dollars backfilling for providing the service. So it's actually pretty exciting that, with those litigation funds being designated to help access to care, that it's being used in that way.
You might want to go to the second one. It's a follow-up to the question.
Okay.
Just trying to make sure that we are addressing the chats in the right order.
So I think the question is that the centers, like if they were to transition to a private center, does it also function as to get someone off of opioids and to manage their pain in another way?
Oh, absolutely. That's what a medication-assisted treatment program does. Is it addresses that addiction and helps them not just through medication management, either using methadone or the other. We offer two, yeah,
Buprenorphine. Please
I've
save
had,
us.
yeah, may,
Buprenorphine. So I almost had it.
buprenorphine, yes. Those are the medications that we typically use and with dosing. And can you repeat that again? I've kind of.
They're just ensuring that whatever new
Oh,
center they
yes.
become, that they're trying to get someone off of opioids to manage their pain in another way. So I think maybe an explanation of how that medicated assistance
Program
program
works.
works, because that is ex exactly what it tries to do.
Right. And it's important to understand that all opioid treatment programs, regardless of whether they're organized as a public entity like we are in under a government or a private entity, there are a massive number of rules under the CFR and SAMHSA and everything else that they're required to meet. And so all opioid treatment programs have to follow the same guidelines and the same laws and the same rules about operating an opioid treatment program. So it's a very highly regulated service that is provided to communities. And the greater concern for our treatment services is. Is there anyone out there that would provide the same level of care on the realm of access to care, treatment quality? We follow best practice treatment protocols, and that's not just with dosing and dispensing, but with counseling and our mental health treatment and those types of things. And meeting the community needs. And so I know that the Board of Health is currently having discussions about how they will make their decision. And a lot of thought is going to be going into whether or not there's any other entity out there that kind of their vision, their mission, their values align with the current treatment services program under SRHD.
And I think, Misty, you were going to clarify some more when it comes to treatment for addiction compared to treatment for pain.
Correct. So thank you. So with OTPs, as you stated before, Alicia, opioid treatment programs are very specific in what we can and cannot do, and we're very highly regulated. And with that means that OTPs can treat addiction with our medications, methadone or buprenorphine, but we cannot treat pain. So when an individual's coming to us, and oftentimes they do have pain issues, and when they come to us with those, we have to defer out to their primary care provider or their specialist. We cannot treat pain on site with those medications. I just wanted to make sure that that was understood because I didn't want any misconceptions of individuals thinking that within our OTP that we are providing care for pain management. That is not the case. OTPs are very specific and very prescribed that we have to address the primary issue of addiction, and any pain management must be treated through their provider or through referral case basis.
Thank you, Misty. That
Of
was
course.
very helpful.
We've been talking a lot because questions came in about funding and about the costs that are incurred when it comes to running treatment services. So I think sometimes for those not hearing about it all the time, they might feel that it's because of the costs that we're trying to not have treatment services division. But that's not the case. So can you
No.
explain just
Right.
why we're doing this and
Right. And so, the 2023 ending the year with a shortfall really was an anomaly. That is not the norm. We've tracked over like 22 years, and over the 22 years, we've only had a handful of years where we ended short in the red, so to speak. And so the dollars issue is not why we're looking at this. The reason that we're looking at this is that there are other entities out there providing the service. And when we first started the methadone clinic back in 1990, we were the only ones. There was no one else in the community that was providing the services. And that's typically what public health does. If we identify a need within the community and no one else is addressing the need, public health steps up to address the need. And that's what we did in 1990. We had a heroin problem here, and we started the methadone clinic. But now there's others who are providing opioid treatment programs. And so when you think about the foundational public health services that are core to public health at the state level, there's a document that kind of outlines the foundational public health services. You'll see that a direct care service like treatment services doesn't fall within the core foundational public health services. There is wiggle room, and if our community was to decide that for our community, providing treatment services is core, that is a decision that could be made. But right now, it's an additional service that does not fall within the core foundational public health services that we provide. So that's one reason. The other reason goes back to what I was talking about, how businesses, they're nimble. They can, they need a new EHR. They just have people come in, show them different options, and they choose one. And if they need to add employees and expand services, they look at it and they say, yep, we need to expand services. We're going to bring on staff. And so like the financial stability of if we made it all the way through step three and we went in this direction, we would do an RFQ process, a request for qualifications. And whatever organizations were to submit requests for qualifications, they would have to show financial stability to be able to do the business and do it well and be able to expand services, et cetera. So we're, our limitations as government are one of the main reasons that we're looking at it, because the problem in Spokane County is so severe.
And other concerns, I know we're looking at the feasibility, but you can address how we're asking about these, is, you know, the employees, and will they still have the same benefits? Will they be able to retain their jobs, level of pay and pension, those kind of questions? And, and I know that's part of your process.
Absolutely. And so when I was talking to the organization yesterday, one of the comments made was that people with the expertise and knowledge and skills to provide care to individuals within an OTP don't grow on trees. So our current employees have the expertise, the knowledge, the skills, the experience that they would want. So they would bring with, like, bring with them the employees. There are, I mean, they have a wonderful benefits package, but there is a reality that as a governmental entity, our employees are part of the PEB system, so the state retirement system. And of course, they wouldn't be public, they wouldn't be a governmental entity, and so employees wouldn't be able to continue contributing to that benefit. But they do have a full benefit package that looks very similar to ours. And I want to let everyone know that as I collect this information from the organizations, I'm not going to keep it hidden. I'm going to figure out a way to share this information with our employees at Treatment Services so that they can see for themselves what these different organizations that I'm talking to, what do their benefits packages look like? What do their pay scales look like? What does the organizational structure of their programming look like in compare, you know, and then they can compare it to what we have.
What another question is, to be a client at our current treatment services, are people having to be a resident within Spokane County or within Washington? And will that change, or will that requirement change if it's shifted to different, to a private treatment services?
Well, that's a question that I actually haven't really looked at. I'm pretty sure, and Misty, jump in if I say something wrong, please. I'm pretty sure that if anybody walks up to us and wants to participate in our treatment program, we don't say, well, you live in Stevens County, so we can't help you. That's not part of the process of seeing if they're eligible for our services. And I do know that we do something called courtesy dosing. So if someone is on a MAP program elsewhere and they are in our, in Spokane County and need to be, to continue the program, that we will do what's called courtesy dosing. And so we do that all the time. And that's just a common thing that OTPs do to make sure that someone visiting from Colorado who's enrolled in a program comes to visit in Spokane, they're able to maintain staying on their program. Of course, there's whole lot of back work that has to be done to ensure that, all the ins and outs, and making sure that they actually are a patient in Colorado. But Misty's team does a fabulous job with doing all of that.
Misty, do you have something to add?
Yes, I was just going to piggyback on what you were saying, Alicia, is that you're correct. We don't require that individuals are strictly in Spokane County. The main caveat with Washington is if an individual has Medicaid, and then those individuals, if they're in Washington State, we bill and have contracts with Washington State MCOs. If they are an Idaho resident, we do not currently have contracts with Idaho Medicaid payers. So that's a separate issue, but our billing team is really phenomenal about working with individuals and whatever their coverage may be. And so as far as maintaining or what our current structure is such that if there's an individual doesn't, I mean, we've had individuals coming from a multitude of different counties in Washington State that come and receive services from us. So Spokane County is not a requirement. Washington State is not a requirement. If someone's coming from Idaho, they're more than welcome to come, and we will work with them on their coverage, who their payer is, and ensuring that they can receive the services and care that they need.
All right, thank you. So I have a couple of questions, but I don't think we completely have the answers, but I want to address them to show that these are
right.
things we could ask or be part of the feasibility study if you don't already. One is like, what would happen with our current new facility for treatment services?
Right.
Yeah.
So, and that's another thing. It's like when I've talked to, again, I have about seven interviews on my schedule, but I've only talked to one entity so far, and they would absolutely want to take on the lease of the building at 8th Avenue. And so, again, appropriate facilities for doing an OTP also aren't growing on trees. And so it's kind of assumed that anyone that would want to take on our treatment services would also be staying right there at the current building.
And this next one, I think that your question of asking the entities about their financial stability, but the concern is that, there's a transition and then that business fails or our community loses the services because of that. But maybe you could just reiterate questions you're asking to try to ensure that.
Right, right. And again, I want to make sure everyone knows that I'm actually not asking about fiscal stability right now. I'm in step one. We would not address that question until we got to step three, when entities were actually submitting their proposals for, as a result of our request for qualification. And so, but the reality in life is life doesn't come with any guarantees. It's like, we as public health, we have many programs that are grant funded. The reality is, if that grant funding goes away, and that grant funding is what provided the service and the employees to do that program, then you have to respond. You know, employees have to be paid. Programs have to be funded. And if you don't have that funding, then we have to eliminate the program. And I know that that has happened. It happens in public health. Fortunately, not a lot. And in Washington State, we are incredibly blessed because the legislature decided to fund the foundational public health services. So we have a relatively stable funding stream now for our public health programming.
And then, Misty, I just in, maybe just to help clarify on the OTPs being able to provide pain management versus medically assisted treatment for addiction, they can't do both. And that goes across the board with our treatment services compared to private treatment services.
That's correct.
Okay.
Because an OTP is very specific in treating addiction. And whereas a pain management clinic, they may be, or a private provider may be able to utilize methadone, but in order to treat pain management, but they cannot treat addiction. So they are very distinctly separate.
All right. We're at 12:51. Do we have any other questions before we wrap up? Closing remarks?
Well, I really want to thank everybody for putting in your questions and your comments. You have a method to continue asking us questions and providing comments using that email address that was provided in the chat. And I'll ask our moderator, our chat moderator, to go ahead and enter that one last time. We want to hear from the community. We are working with Better Health Together. They're helping us to put together three different sector-focused listening sessions, town halls, and that we'll be announcing the dates for those as they become available and as they've been set. I will continue to give updates on the progress of the feasibility study at the Board of Health meetings. Those are also recorded and they occur on the fourth Thursday of the month, except in August and November. So if you want to stay tuned, I would highly recommend watching the Board of Health meeting, whether it's live or in the recording. I'll do my best to keep everybody updated, and you're always welcome to reach out if you want additional information.
All right. Well, thank you. This will conclude today's town hall meeting. Thank you all for coming out today and for sharing your time with us. We really appreciate it.
Thank you. Have a great day.